with us, Dr. Sanjay Parekh. Dr. Sanjay Parekh has pursued his master's in microbiology from Gujarat University, PhD in microbiology from South Gujarat University. He possesses a vast teaching experience of 15 years in the subject of microbiology. He has attended number of state level, national level, as well as international conferences, as well as a workshop.
Sir, we are welcoming you on behalf of Department of Biotechnology, Ramakrishna Institute. Please.
Thank you, friends. Thank you for my kind introduction, Dr. Marjadi. Students, today the topic which we will be discussing is about, as you can see on the slide, virology. Now, when we are talking about virology, that means it's a science that deals with viruses. Actually, the word virology is consist of two things, virus plus logy. So it's a science that deals with study of viruses. Now, when we are going to discuss about viruses, we are supposed to understand first what are viruses. As you know, you have learned virology at some extent. You learn about viruses, you know about viruses, that these are the kind of ultra microscopic entities which prevailing in the environment. Viruses, if you want to define, then we can define it as they are acellular, obligatory intracellular parasites having either DNA or RNA as a genetic material. This few things which I have just mentioned over here, which gives a complete idea about the totally distinct entities which is prevailing in nature. Let's understand one by one what I said just now. Acellular. Now, many of you are coming from the botany background, many of you are coming from the zoological background or a biotechnology or a microbiology. When we are saying something that is cellular and acellular, that means cellular having certain defined structure. But these are the kind of entities what we called acellular, that doesn't have any cell organelles, or there is something what you can say a fixed structure. See, at every aspects I will be explaining you and I will be telling you that why this entity is special than compared to the other entities. Acellular, it doesn't match up with a plant kingdom, it doesn't match up with an animal kingdom, or even it doesn't match up with a kingdom bacteria. That's why this is a separate entity. Acellular, doesn't have a defined cell structure. Second aspect, obligatory intracellular parasites. There are numbers of parasites you might have learned in animal sciences, but this is something what I call obligatory intracellular parasites. Obligatory, that's a mandatory. For their multiplication, they required a host cell. And in the presence of their host cells, they can only survive, they can only multiply. In the absence of their host cells, they cannot survive. That's why they are obligatory intracellular parasites. Once again, they require host cell not only for their replication. They are completely parasitic in nature, that means they are utilizing their host cells mechanism, all the machineries, for their own replication for their own developments. That's why they are obligatory intracellular parasites. And the third and the last, the most important characteristics of this entity, which never match up with any of the living organisms right now existing on this planet Earth. Once again, I would like to repeat. The last characteristic which I am going to mention is the kind of characteristics which makes this entity completely different from the kingdom animal, the kingdom plant, or even the group of bacteria, what you have learned. And that is, they possess either DNA or RNA as a genetic material. Now, what do we mean by either DNA or RNA? Up till now, Watson and Crick, once he has been find out that DNA structure, we are know that DNA is a genetic material of a living cell. Whether it is rat, plant, elephant, dinosaur, to take the name of the living creature on this planet having DNA as a genetic material. But this is the only entity where there are certain groups which are having RNA that act as a genetic material. That is the reason why this is a separate branch. This is the reason why this is completely a different entities, which are titled under a separate discipline as a virology. So if you will understand what are their basic properties, then we can understand what are viruses. And once we learn what are viruses, then we will understand how they are connected with us. So I'm just consider you have understood what are viruses, and the concept must be clear. The difference between viruses, plant, animal, and the microorganisms other than this viruses. This is the one second I would like to point it out over here. This is the only community, this is the only entity rather, where RNA act as a genetic material. You will never find the such thing in, and yes, there are one exceptions. There is one exception. As I said, either DNA or RNA. Means either DNA is present as a genetic material or RNA is present as a genetic material. But there is one exception. There is one virus where both DNA and RNA are present at a time. That is human cytomegalovirus. In this virus, both DNA and RNA are present at a time, act as a genetic material. So this is something you might not aware that there is an exception even in the group of viruses. That is the human cytomegalovirus, where both DNA and RNA act as a genetic material. Let's start with the historical background of virology, that how people come to know about what are viruses. When people notice the existence of viruses and how this community come forward against the group of people or against the scientists, that such kind of even ultra microscopic entities, I have to use that word, not a microscopic, it's an ultra microscopic entity which are existing, what we call a virus. If you will just check the history of virology, then here I would like to just show you one of the picture. This is the oldest case of polio was discovered on a stone engraving in Egypt, that dates to the 3000 years back. As you can see in this picture, a person here is shown. This is a person who is suffering from poliomyelitis. This is the case of 3000 years back. And by going through this stone engraving, we will come to know that existence of virus is just happened to be there along with the evolution of life on this planet. So, as you can see, this person is having the typical symptoms where that motions and muscles contractions are become fail and that you can see. So presence of virus and their disease in a human community were prevailing even 3000 years back, but their systematic study, their proper understanding and their nature later on followed systematically. And if you want to start, then we must not forget the contribution of Lady Wortley Montagu. She is the one who is actually a wife of an ambassador and who has in the 17th century carried out inoculations. That is what we nowadays called a vaccination. That inoculation of a smallpox lesions. So in those early days when a children acquired a smallpox, and you must be knowing that some sort of blisters are appearing on your skin, so they are just scraping that material and injecting into the healthy individual, and they realize that the individual who are injected with it get protection against the smallpox infection. They never acquired that infection later on in their life. Once again, that's a, what you can say, a kind of not a scientific approach, or rather there is no scientific understanding behind it, but this practice has led to convince the people that if you want to get protected against the smallpox, then you have to inoculate that lesions into your younger kids and they will remain protected against that particular infection. And that same practice was later on continued and systematically followed by Edward Jenner in the end of 17th century, that is around in 1798, where he prevented the smallpox by exposure to the cowpox. So it's a some similar kind of disease rather, where a person was specifically engaged with milking process, rather a milkman, and such kind of disease are obviously observed in a cow, where that disease is called a cowpox. And by during their routine practice, if a cowpox affected animals and that milkman get that lesion from cowpox, and it has observed that if a person is inoculated with a cowpox lesions, then that person automatically get immunity against a smallpox. Nowadays your knowledge has reached to the level that you understand without giving any reasons that it is nothing, but it's just a kind of exposure to the antigens in that individual, so it produce the antibody. So whenever that real smallpox virus will enter into the body, already that antibodies are ready to combat it, and that person get the, but that was what the practice was carried out, and that's why that he has systematically carried out inoculation and he got the success, and that's why he is known as the father of vaccination, Edward Jenner. Even Louis Pasteur has studied the case of rabies. Then now that actual study of viruses and specifically the isolation of viruses, so when we are talking about a Charles Chamberlain, he was the one who made a remarkable contribution by 2-3 things in the field of microbiology. First, he was the one who has first time designed the filter. He was the one who has discovered or rather designed autoclave. Okay, so Charles Chamberlain developed a porcelain bacterial filters, and by passing the viral infected material through the filter, and whatever the filtrate absorbed, he found that that filtrate still contained that efficiency to lyse the culture. And then after that, Dmitry Ivanovsky, that's an infectious leaf extract of tobacco mosaic disease. He has studied that leaf extract of tobacco mosaic infected plant. And then Martin is burgeoning. He was the one who have coined that term, a filterable viruses, that is by studying a tobacco mosaic viruses. Still, that history continues. Loffer and Frosch, they have once again continue with that term, and a filterable virus caused the hoof and mouth disease in a cattle was reported by him. Then a Walter Reed in 19th century, he studied the yellow fever, a disease in humans that was caused by once again a filterable virus transmitted through the mosquito. Here once again people came to know about the role of vectors in transmitting disease between a two separate living community. After that, he was the one who has introduced that a group of viruses, what nowadays we call arboviruses. These arboviruses, that is arthropod-borne viruses, these are the viruses mainly responsible for transmitting disease between animal and humans. So there are a group of viruses. Then Ellerman and Bung in 1908 showed the leukemia in chicken was caused by a virus. Nowadays that virus was identified by Pete and Rose, that a muscle tumor in chickens was caused by a virus, that what we call a Rose sarcoma virus. Then Frederick Watt, bacteria infecting a virus. So up till now, before the Frederick Watt, people were knowing that there are a filterable agent, filterable viruses which are infecting a kind of cells which are quite larger than these viruses, whether a plant cell or an animal cell. But now this remarkable observation from Frederick Watt that suggests that a bacteria infecting virus are identified, what they call bacteriophage or simply phages. Then a Felix T. Herrell, the existence of bacteriophage. Not only that, he has also given an enumeration method for, that is what we call more commonly a plaque assay, that was introduced by Felix T. Herrell. And he also said that these are the viruses which are reproduced only in a living bacteria, because when he has inoculated that filtrate on a lawn of bacterial growth, then he found that a plaque formation occurs. This is nothing but the lawn of bacterial mass is going to be infected by the viruses, and then that ultimately going to destroy, completely carried out a destruction of bacterial cell mass that leads to a formation of a clear zone within a plate, and surrounding there is a bacterial lawn. So you can say that's a clear zone, what we used to call it as a plaque. So later on, the contribution of Wendell M. Stanley, he is the one who has first time crystallized tobacco mosaic virus. Once the virus particle were crystallized, then the direction opens to study their chemical nature. Then the answer of a question, that is what viruses are made up of, will be available to the community. So TMV, he found that it was completely composed of a protein. But later on, Borden and Peary was said that it's not only made up of a protein, but along with protein there is a presence of nucleic acid. That was finally proved, and now we know that viruses are made up of two things, protein and nucleic acids. So this is what I have just tried to recollect your understanding regarding the history of virology, that how viruses are come into the existence, however they were exist earlier, but how people came to know about the viruses by the remarkable contribution of such peoples. So once again, if you have digested that the earlier definition which I have told you, viruses are acellular, obligatory, intracellular parasites having either DNA or RNA act as a genetic material. Then if you will stick with this definition, then to understand the viruses will become more easy. Obligatory intracellular parasites means for their further growth, they require a host. But as long as host is not available, then outside the host cell, they are nothing but simply a mass of chemical. And this mass of chemical can persist for infinite period of time. Until and unless no incidents occur that will destruct this mass of chemicals. You got my point? Outside the host cell, they are something like a mass of chemicals. In another words, they are non-living. But as soon as they enter into their appropriate host cell, they are showing all those sequences which are generally observed in a living cell. This is the reason that I would like to add one more thing that you might have learned in your school days, that viruses are the linkages between living and non-living. You must have learned that typical phrase, sajivane nirjivane jorti kadi. Because they can act both during their life. They can act as a non-living matter as long as they are outside the host cell. But as soon as they got their host cells, they start multiplying, they increase their number, they just act like a living material. So in that previous definition, I would like to add these things. And that's why the viral particle which is outside the host cell, now onwards we will call it viron. So you can use this term viron when that virus particle is not within the host cell. Viron is nothing but it's an extracellular form of virus. Here I would like to clear all that terminology which are supposed to be used in our upcoming discussions. So what is viron is usually made up of? It consists of a one molecule of DNA, as I told you, either DNA or RNA, except that human cytomegalovirus, where both are present. But here it consists of one or more than one. Once again, I just stick with the word, one or more than one molecule of either DNA or RNA, which are enclosed in a protein. Now that enclosing protein, what we call a capsid. This is something what we call a kind of coat that protects nucleic acid, either DNA or RNA, whichever is present in that particular viral particles. And that's why now that capsid, which is made up of protein, nucleic acid, which is made up of either DNA or RNA, both together are called nucleocapsid. Alone protein part, capsid, presence of nucleic acid, then both are called nucleocapsids. Are you getting this? Because if you have understood that term nucleocapsid, then we can understand the further symmetry of this nucleocapsid, that accordingly it will give you a kind of structure variations among the viruses. Not only that, there are certain viruses, they are having besides this an additional layer. Obviously that additional layer consists of a lipid membrane, which is usually derived from their host cell. Just be attentive at this point, because this is usually what happens. Envelope never synthesized by the viruses. It is usually derived by the viruses at the time of maturation or at the time of budding process, when they are going to be bud out from their respective host cell. Okay, so this is the additional layer. Once again, this additional layer is not found to be present in all viruses, few. So this additional layer, what we call envelopes. And now the presence of this envelope will going to give you a two broad category of viruses when we are going to discuss in our upcoming slides about the type of viruses. That will give you a two totally different group, naked viruses and enveloped viruses. So now you understand what do we mean by naked viruses. They are just having a nucleocapsid, nucleic acid, capsid, that's it. But enveloped viruses, nucleic acid, capsid, plus there is a membrane. Okay, so this enveloped layer or enveloped viruses, it's a host derived membrane structure. See, that's an important thing. In their whole lifespan, they are not going to synthesize this thing. It is always going to be gifted them from their host cells. In fact, it is not gifted, it is going to be taken by them from their host cells. Then, in that lipid envelope bilayer or single layer membrane, there are certain carbohydrates are present. Sometimes certain proteins are present. Now, these carbohydrates and proteins gives them a kind of characteristics. These are the responsible for their antigenicity. These are responsible for their antigenic characteristics. And due to the presence of this such carbohydrates, protein and lipid, it gives them another important characteristics, that is host specificity. As it is derived from the host, they are having that structure, and that's why that respective host cell only identified that structure. That is the reason that particular virus only infect that particular host cells. Even if the other cells are present, they are not going to be infected by it. That's why some papillomas or spike-like structures are observed. In upcoming slide, we will see some of the examples and that shapes I will be showing you at that time. When we will be discussing the structure, you will understand that what are the spikes are there and how they are helpful for their host specificity. So, what is viral capsid is all about? It's nothing but a kind of a protein shell or a coat that encloses the nucleic acid, that is genome. Now, what are the functions? Obviously, the obvious function of this capsid is to protect the nucleic acid. See, usually during my classes, I used to tell my students, if you really want to know how to live a simple life or simplicity in a life, we should learn from the viruses only. એને સાદગી ભર્યું અને સાદાઈવાળું જીવન કેવું ને, કે જીવનમાં જરૂરી જોઈતી જ વસ્તુઓ રાખવાની, બીજા વસ્તુની વધારાની જરૂર ના હોય. દેટ યુ કેન લર્ન ફ્રોમ વાયરસીસ ઓનલી, બિકોઝ ધે નો ઇફ ધે વોન્ટ ટુ મલ્ટીપ્લાય, ધે વિલ જસ્ટ સિમ્પલી ટ્રાન્સફર ધેર ન્યુક્લિક એસિડ ઇન ટુ ધ હોસ્ટ સેલ, નોટ ઇવન મોર દેન ધીસ. દેટ્સ વાય ધે જસ્ટ પ્રોટેક્ટ એન્ડ કેરી ધેર ન્યુક્લિક એસિડ ઓનલી. It's because they know, as long as we will keep our genetic material safe, and protect it, we will remain on this planet forever. No extra, no flagella, nothing. No extra organelles, no need. They have to just protect their DNA or whatever the genetic material they possess. Okay? Very simple in their life. No extra anything, because they are being an obligatory intracellular parasite. Once they goes inside, everything is there. So obviously the function of a capsid is going to give or protect the viral nucleic acids, participate in viral infections, and share the antigenicity. So that's an important thing. That's antigenic characteristics ultimately makes them a host specificity. That gives that contribution, that gives that attribute to the viruses, host specificity. That the viruses which infect that particular group of host cells are unable to infect another group of host cells. It is due to that antigenicity. It is the antigens which are going to be recognized at the time of infection. It's something like a lock and key model. Okay. And that this is how they flourish in the nature. That core of virus particle consisting of a genome plus a complex of proteins. So see, there is nothing a single type of protein. However, once again, I would like to appreciate the simplicity of the viruses, that they assemble their whole structure by coding a single gene. By coding a single gene, they prepare their whole structure. Once again, a law of simplicity you can see in their lifestyle. They carry only a single gene, and there is no other option for them. Being ultra microscopic in size, they cannot afford to carry more number of genes. Just like even a bacteria, or just like us, 23 pairs of chromosomes. We can afford. We can have a luxury. We have a different set of genes for digesting that particular carbohydrates. Small size. Small nucleic acid, they have to carry a very few number of genes rather. Many times not even a set of genes. Few genes, 5 or 6 genes is sufficient. Okay. So, many times a single protein monomer will make up the whole structure of a virus. Single type of protein. But yes, it's an arrangement of that protein within that capsid is important. I'll be showing you in our upcoming slides that a single protein molecule is established the complete virus molecule or complete nucleocapsid. A single type. That's why they have to produce, or they have to carry out a translation of a single gene. They carry a single gene that will produce a single type of protein, and only with the help of that single type of protein, but obviously the multiple copies of that protein are arranged together in such a way that will produce a capsid. It's not applicable to all the viruses. However, there are certain viruses which are having even more than one type of protein molecules. So there are complex of proteins exist. So here once again we will just go through the classification of viruses.